Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Welcome back to Sunday morning and the old cookbook show. Today we're going to do a recipe out of a cookbook that we've worked with before. And that's this book right here, published in 1800 in Edinburgh, written by Mrs. Fraser. The Practice of Cookery, Pastry, Confectionery, Pickling, and Preserving, with directions for choosing provisions, trussing poultry, etc., to which is added an appendix, blah, 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 blah. It goes on, like, the entire title page is the title of this book. And we're going to make something called to fricassee chickens with a white sauce. And so fricassee in of itself is cooking usually chicken, but sometimes other birds, fowl, and rabbits. And we'll get to that in a little bit with that cookbook. Where you first fry it in some butter, and then you braise it in a liquid, and then you finish it in a gravy or a white sauce or a creamy sauce, which sounds remarkably like a recipe we did a couple of weeks ago, and I didn't really delve into that recipe too much. We made something called Smothered Chicken from an American cookbook in 1939. And I'm going to do this recipe out of order because the first part of this recipe tells you to dress the chickens. And fortunately, in 2021, someone else is dressing the chickens for me. And I didn't get whole chickens. I got chicken thighs because I like chicken thighs. And they were less expensive this week at the grocery store than a whole chicken. So, you know, I went with what I could get. So into this pot tells me to use good veal gravy. And veal gravy or veal stock. Essentially veal stock. They're not asking for gravy as we would think of it today in 2021 as something that's already thickened. They're asking me to use veal stock and then to thicken it with butter and flour. So instead of veal stock, I'm using chicken stock, and we're going to thicken it with butter and flour. We're going to make what's called beurre meunier or beurre meunier. So beurre meunier is a classic French technique for thickening a sauce that you've already got on the go, or a stock that you've already got on the go, in order to make a gravy. The butter or the fat or whatever fat you're using instead of butter coats the flour so that when you mix it into the liquid, it doesn't clump together. The flour adds thickening, the butter adds a little bit of a glossiness to the sauce. Fantastic way for making any sort of gravy, turkey gravy, chicken gravy, anything like that. I use it all the time. You've seen me do it before. I'm ready to go with that. I'm just going to bring the chicken stock up to a boil before I add that in and start thickening it. Brings us to the chicken. So I've got the chicken thighs here and I have an egg yolk. And I'm going to break the egg yolk and rub the egg yolk all over the chicken pieces and get them fully coated in egg yolk. It's messy, but your hand is the best and only way to do this. Okay, clean hands. Now, we need to season the chicken. And the recipe tells us to use white spice and salt. It took me a little while to sort of read through a lot of the recipes in this book, and so when they say white spice, they mean white pepper, and they use that term interchangeably throughout recipes in this book. Miss Fraser uses that term interchangeably throughout this book, and even interchangeably within one recipe, because later in the recipe it says white pepper. So I've got white pepper here, and white pepper is something that you see a lot of in cooking in this time period. So I'm going to sprinkle that on top, along with some salt. And I'm going to do both sides, but I noticed that the chicken stock is boiling, so we're going to use the beurre meunier to thicken that up. So I've got a clump about that big. I'm going to put that in first and see where that gets us. And a whisk. And I might put in a little bit more, just to thicken it up a little bit further. Probably use all of that. Now we need to brown the chicken. So the recipe tells me to heat up some sweet butter in a frying pan. which is unsalted butter. If you only have salted butter, it's fine. Use salted butter. You don't need to keep unsalted butter in your kitchen just because. And the farther back you go in history, the delineation between salted and unsalted butter becomes more and more important. Today in 2021, big industrial butter that is salted is pretty much all salted to the same salt content or the same amount of salt in the butter. There's a little bit of variation between brands, but for the most part, it's regulated and it's fairly consistent, and you know how salty butter is at this point. And so you can adjust your salt somewhere else in the recipe. In this case, maybe don't put as much salt on the chicken. In 1800, when this cookbook was written, and even pretty much any time before World War I, a lot of households would have made their own butter, and they would have salted it completely differently. And so there would have been a much larger variation in salt content in salted butter between household to household, town to town, village to village. It would have been a big deal then. It's not that big a deal today, and especially not in savory cooking. In baking, I would tend to agree that if the recipe says use unsalted or sweet butter, use unsalted or sweet butter, or know your salt level and figure it out and adjust in the rest of the recipe. But in a savory dish, I don't think it's that big of a deal. So I'm going to brown this at this point, in the butter at this point. And it says to brown lightly on both sides, so you're not looking for a huge amount of color. So get the chicken in there and get it going. So while the chicken is browning, let's talk about fricassee. Prior to World War I, fricassee turns up in pretty much every cookbook that I own. Very common recipe. And in the community cookbooks, there would be many variations on it. And from cookbook to cookbook, there's lots of variations on it. And down through time, it starts to, you see the variations. Country to country, you see the variations. This is a very common fricassee recipe from England, UK, Scotland in this time period around 1800. French cookbooks do it a little bit differently, and then you start to see it in American cookbooks as well, called fricassee, and a different interpretation again. After World War I, in Canada and the United States, the term fricassee falls out of favor. The recipe remains, the recipe continues, but it takes on other names, like the one we did a couple of weeks ago called smothered chicken. And that is, I think that's due to a whole bunch of reasons, and you know, people could debate this forever and ever and ever, but part of it is, I have to choose my words very carefully. There are a lot of people that if you went to their house and brought a potluck dish or had people over to your house and they asked you, what are we having for supper? And you said, fricassee of chicken, you might get two very different reactions. One would be, ooh, what's that? I don't know what that is. I don't want to eat it. And the other reaction would be, ooh, fricassee of chicken. When really this is just a very plain, simple stew. The people who think that it's going to be elevated might be disappointed, and the people who won't eat it, well, they're not going to eat it. But if you drop down something and call it smothered chicken, you're probably going to please everybody at the table. They know immediately what it is. It's smothered. They don't really care what it's smothered in. It's just smothered, and it's chicken. It's going to be good. And so post-World War I, you start to see that change in language and a simplification of the recipe, like the one we did a couple of weeks ago. But if you go back, this is a cookbook printed, published in 1685 by Robert May, and it has a fricassee recipe. It's called A Rare Fricassee. And it starts out, take 6 pigeons and 6 chicken peepers, or 6 young chickens, or 6 chicks. And then you go through this really long process, but it uses yolks, eggs, sweetbreads, lamb bones. It uses mutton gravy, oysters, asparagus, bone marrow, nutmeg, and clove or two of garlic, if you please. I mean, this is a complicated recipe, but they're all kind of related in the same way that you're first frying or browning the meat, chicken in this case, and then you're poaching it or braising it in a stock or a sauce or wine or something like that. So now we pour in the stock. Might turn that down a little bit so it's not on volcano. And we put the lid on and cook that for a quarter hour. Now, in order to thicken up the sauce, I am supposed to cast 3 yolks of eggs, which I have. I've cast them together until smooth. And I'm supposed to add 1/2 gill of cream. Now, this is a Scottish cookbook. In the front section, it says that both Scottish measurements and English measurements are given. Except where they're the same and then only one measurement is given. In this case, it says 1/2 gill. Now, a gill, an imperial gill, a British gill, a gill used in this time period in England and Scotland is different than a gill used in the United States. The United States went their own way with pretty much all of those measurements. So when I use a gill here in this recipe, it is completely different than a gill that the Townsends might use in one of their American recipes. Same word, different measurement. So I'm gonna put that together like that. Calls for the squeeze of a lemon. So we'll get a squeeze of a lemon. I'll squeeze it through my fingers to catch any pips. I think that's probably a squeeze. Give that a stir. That's gonna start curdling immediately, right? Because you put an acid in with the eggs and the cream. Now, I need to take the lid off. This is cooked long enough. I need to take some of the gravy out of this pot and put it in with the eggs and the cream in order to temper it so the eggs don't scramble when we put it back in to thicken up the sauce. So, a little bit at a time. A couple of scoops are going to be more than enough just to bring the temperature up. And then we mix the whole together. Get that in there. And it says to give it a shake over the fire before serving. So I'm just gonna cook this probably another 5 minutes or so just to thicken up that sauce. And it started to thicken up almost immediately. I think the sauce is gonna be fantastic. The chicken is pretty much cooked. I'm just gonna put the lid on and I'm gonna turn it down a little bit until Julie gets home from work. This is the type of dish that is really forgiving. So if you put it on and you think someone's gonna be home at, you know, 5:30, 5:45, turns out they're not coming home until 6:30, it's not a big deal. Just turn it down, put the lid on, keep it warm. It's gonna be fine. It's very forgiving. So we'll see you when Julie gets home.
Hey, Jules. Hey, friends.
Okay. Forks.
Forks. Good to know.
And a knife, probably.
And a knife. Okay.
Look at that. Okay. Just give the sauce a little bit of a stir. Oh, that looks really good. Okay. Now, it smells really good, too.
Tell me more.
Fricassee of chicken, or chicken fricassee. You're going to notice that it is smothered chicken. It's the same dish that we had a couple of weeks ago. This is just going back a little bit farther in time.
Okay. sure. What do I know, eh?
So sauce on top. This is a more involved recipe. This is a more involved recipe, so the chicken is browned a little bit nicer. Mm-hmm. There'll be a little bit more flavor to it. You're supposed to put as you serve it, put sliced lemon on top for the serving platter.
Really, that's for later.
Well, it uses up the lemon because, you know, you're only using a squeeze of lemon, so if you've bought the lemon, you might as well use the whole lemon. Oh, turning that off.
I remember the sauce is pretty.
Oh, that's really good.
Mm-hmm.
That is really good. Okay.
Yeah. Well, you need to just eat the sauce straight up, do you? Yeah, that's lovely. It's moist. It's got some flavor to it.
Yeah. So going back a little bit more involved, but I'm going to say the flavor from that sauce is way better than the flavor from the other sauce that we had. And it still only has salt and pepper on it.
Right? So what do you think that what makes the difference? What will you surmise?
Well, the lemon adds a little bit of acidity,
mm-hmm,
that pulls it together a little bit more. We didn't use water. We used chicken stock.
Ah.
The recipe calls for veal stock, but using that chicken stock really sort of bumps the flavor up.
We didn't have a lot of veal stock.
No.
And,
and there are proponents. There is a very famous TV chef who is a large proponent of don't use stock, just use water because the stock doesn't bring any flavor. I'm going to fully disagree with that. The stock brings a huge amount of flavor. And there's enough sauce here that I could have done, you know, three times as many chicken thighs.
Yes, there does appear to be a lot of sauce.
There is enough sauce here to do two small chickens. Fantastic. So I think...
You and I just can't eat two small chickens.
No, we can't eat two small chickens.
It's not a good plan.
No, so don't be afraid of recipe names. If you get freaked out by a recipe name because it's called fricassee of chicken, but you make smothered chicken, fricassee doesn't mean that it's harder. And there's only a couple more steps to this one than the simplified version, and I think the couple more steps add a lot of extra flavor. I don't know about the one with the pigeons, though. That had a lot of extra steps. I'll show that recipe to you later.
What are you talking about?
It's from this cookbook from
the squab.
From
isn't that the
1685?
It's cooking term for pigeons, squab.
Squab, 1685.
Mm. 1685.
Yeah,
okay.
Was it? Yeah, take six pigeons and six chicken peepers.
Chicken peepers.
Chicks. So not even full-grown chickens.
What? Not the little marshmallows?
Oh. Marshmallow peeps. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Too far.
This is a great recipe. So if you make a simplified version, bump it up a little bit and try this one. Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon.